זהו. ההרצאה האחרונה שלנו היום, Radiolab and Saddam Hussein's Octopus. באמת חיכינו לזה וקיווינו שהוא יגיע. לפני שנתיים במסגרת 8 דקות כאן בכנס, ברק חיימוביץ' ואני דיברנו על התוכניות השוות ביותר שאתם כנראה לא מכירים, ורדיולאב הייתה אולי במקום המרכזי ביותר עם אחד הפרקים המפורסמים שהביאו, הפרק נקרא Colors, הביאו מקהלה שלמה לשיר את הקשת בענן, לפרוץ את גבולות האודיו כמו שאנחנו מכירים. אני לא בטוחה שאז חלמנו שתגיע רוברט, אבל הנה הוא, זוכה פרס האמי, מנחה התוכנית המצליחה, עטורת הפרסים, רדיולאב, תענוג גדול שאתה איתנו כאן, וסיום מפואר לכנס שלנו. אז בבקשה, רוברט קורוביץ'.
Well, it was a long sit, but I'm finally here. Thank you very much. Also, you know, when you gave the award to the folks that you gave the award to, one of the people in that group was our Radiolab intern only like 9 weeks ago. And I feel the meme spreading through the world, and I was just very kind of flattered. And I was sitting here thinking, gosh, like, what, 10, 11 years ago, I was just with this young guy I'm going to talk about. We were just sitting around just trying to make something up. And what we made up is now I can feel it just sort of percolating and spreading and moving around the globe. So I want to talk to you just briefly about Radiolab. It is a sometimes science-y, it's sometimes investigative, it's sometimes just a plain old adventure program. It's gotten very, very popular for being, among other things, curious, playful, and it's a very odd duet. I do it with somebody, Jed Abumrad, who is 25 years younger than I am. So it's a pairing of two very different guys with very different perspectives. His family is from Beirut, by way of Tennessee, and my family is from, I guess, somewhere in Poland, by way of New York City. And for some reason, the two of us, we share a crazy sense of wonder and play. And it is also a program that when we invented it, I was trying to solve a problem that I have had all my life. I have been a reporter for a very, very long time. And like most reporters, I look around and I notice things. And when I see something that intrigues me, I think, whoa, how can that be? So and in my case, I could look at a cloud and I think, well, it's full of water. Water is heavy. If we took a piece of a cloud and measured it, we'd say, well, there's a couple of millimeters of water, but the size of that cloud, there's like 500, 5,000 tons of water. Why doesn't it fall onto the ground? Or I'll see a snail having sex with another snail, and I'm told that the snails are hermaphrodites, so they have penises, and they also have these eggs that they're trying to protect. To have a penis and to have the eggs is a complicated thing when you're meeting another animal who has also got a penis and eggs. So you, with the penis, you kind of want to be a poker and say hello to the other. But if with the eggs, you think, well, I think this other snail has a cold. I don't want him to get too close to me. Down here, I'm happy to get close to it. But up here, get away. And I'm thinking, wow, this is very complicated, being a snail. And it suggests that to divide animals into males and females, this is just a very convenient way to build an animal. Snails, I guess, didn't get the memo. And then we just think around, like, what would it be like to be a snail? It's like sometimes what we do at our editorial meetings, so you can only imagine. And the thing is, for my whole life, the things that I have found fascinating, my bosses often don't find fascinating. And yet I have to keep going into newsrooms with this conviction that what I find remarkable about being alive and looking around is something that I will have to convince them or seduce them into doing. And it has never been easy from when I started till right now. And it gets me into all kinds of trouble. So just to give you a case in point. One time I got a videotape from a marine biologist in Massachusetts, and I turned it on and I looked at it and I thought, oh my God, oh my God. It shows an octopus in shallow Caribbean water doing something I'd never seen anything like this before. So I ran down to my boss's office. His name was Peter Jennings, and he was the presenter of the evening news on ABC, where I worked. And he's an anchor and a famous man, and he has a desk, and he doesn't really like, you can't just charge into the room. But I would always charge into the room. And I say, oh my gosh, Peter, I have an octopus story that is going to knock your socks off. He's like, let me just put it into your machine. He goes, no. I said, what do you mean, no? You haven't even seen it yet. I'm going to just stick it here into your tape deck. You are going to be so surprised. So it's only 2 minutes long, and it's the best octopus story you'll ever see in your life. He said, I'm not doing your octopus story today. No. Looks, I said, why not? He said, it may have escaped your notice, Krolwich, but the U.S. Army has just occupied Baghdad. We have conquered the place. Saddam Hussein and his two sons, Uday and the other one, have gone missing, and we are looking for them, and that's what the I said, the whole show? You're going to do the whole show about these two missing children? You have 18 and a half minutes. I've got just 2 minutes of octopus coverage. I'm sure we can work out a deal here. He goes, no deal. I said, well, all right. I said, how about this? Suppose I make my octopus story about Saddam Hussein. Now I have his full attention. I don't know exactly what mood he was in. He said, well, now how would that work? I said, I don't know. I don't know how that would work. Now, I'm not particularly pleased or proud of what I'm about to show you. But Eitan, if you can run it, let's just hear. This is what went on ABC News. I'm so embarrassed. We'll come up in just a moment. After Saddam and his son stole more than $1 billion, there's talk now that he is searching for a cosmetic surgeon to disguise himself. Well, Saddam the dictator might want to meet Saddam the octopus, because some octopuses really know how to disappear, says biologist Roger Hanlon.
This is what octopuses do for a living. They disappear all the time.
For example, Roger saw this bush in shallow Caribbean water, but as he moved closer, now watch the bush. Look at this.
All right.
Look. It squirts ink and runs. That's good.
This one's one of the best.
We got to see this again. Let's go backwards before it ran away to when the octopus was all puffed up to look big and scary. And now, backwards and in slow motion, watch the eyes. You see how the pigment is changing back to a dark algae and rock color? And the skin, if you look, it's beginning to pucker. It becomes more rock-like. This is deliberate.
So if they see the algae next to them, they can mimic the algae.
Yeah, it's definitely getting lumpier all over. And this is happening. The muscle changes and the color changes. How long in real time?
It takes less than a second to make any of these changes, so they can become a rock in less than a second. It's instantaneous.
I mean, yeah. Really, right? I mean,
the
absolutely.
Octopus and its cousin, the cuttlefish, this is a cuttlefish, are simply, says Roger, the planet's masters of disguise. Nobody, watch this cuttlefish, nobody does it better. So if plastic surgeons could figure out what the octopus does, certain people might pay considerable sums of money, especially for a quick change.
I think the octopus can
you applaud, but this is like I'm sitting
Earth,
in the newsroom like
plastic surgery would be pretty cool.
Indeed. Robert Krolwich, ABC News.
This is how hard you have to fight to get science stories onto news shows. And you ask yourself, like, why is it so hard? I mean, I don't blame Peter Jennings for wanting to cover Saddam's story. Of course he should cover it. But the problem here is the news business, like most mature businesses, has a routine, has a deep routine. It's a way of seeing the world. So I'll tell you what it's like, what it's been like for me for years. On a typical morning, you have your morning news meeting, and they go around the room and say, okay, what do you have today? And the reporters and the editors, they pitch stories. So they say, well, I have the governor's press conference.
Okay.
I have a three-alarm fire.
Okay, three-alarm fire, good.
I have the sporting event that everybody cares about.
Good sporting event, like that.
I've got a murder, always like murders. And they say, I have a plant that turns into an octopus. They say, now, the whole room goes, what? What do you mean? What do you have? What? So I have a plant that turns into an octopus. Now at 10 in the morning, that's the best story of the day. It's early in the day. People think, well, governors come, governors go. Plants turning into octopuses is unusual. I want to know more about that. But now here's what happens. At around noon, the governor gives a press conference. the other companies, NBC, CBS, are there there too. And so, you know, he says something, so then you know it's going to be on their show, so, well, now they're going to do it, so you have to do it too. And there's a fire, you got to do a fire, and there's a tornado warning, well, you have to do that. And then slowly but surely you watch your octopus story drop lower and lower and lower on the schedule of things for the day, because octopus turning into bushes is just not something you have to have on the news show. It's something you could have if there's nothing else going on. And at about 3:30, you hear the quiet sound of your story dying. Because after all, they've been doing this for millions of years. This is actually what you saw as a willful act by an intelligent animal manipulating its skin purposefully and knowingly, which is a miracle to me. But the next day, the same thing happens. 10, you're good. 12, you're not. And again, and again, and again. And my problem as a science reporter in a general newsroom is what I love to talk about seemed, for some reason, a little dangerous. We know what news shows like to hear. They love weather, crime, big, politics, wonderful, sports, definitely, celebrities, pop culture, of course, war, necessary, health, yep, science, a little complicated, a little scary, sometimes mathematical, and technical or complicated. So there's just no inclination to go there. So Peter Jennings, this producer, this presenter at ABC, said, well, one day he looked at me irritated and said, what do you do here anyway? I said, well, I know what you do. You do this just in. Like, he just got shot. He just got elected. He just said something. He just lost his job. But I think about this always is. And I think this always is often just as interesting as this just in if, and this is the crucial part, if the reporter knows how to tell these tales, knows how to turn complexity into delight or into a kind of beauty. And it's beauty, really, is what you're after. And that is what spawned Radiolab. A reporter who chooses the unexpected, who doesn't want to fit in, who has to deliver stories in a way that bend the routine and make something dangerous seem delightful, which takes a sense of craft, it takes a sense of drama, it takes an inner sense of dignity, and it takes, I believe, a musical sense. And it's all these things, I think, that have come into play, and it's about what Radiolab is challenging. We really believe, deeply believe, in the advantage of playfulness. There is, and certainly in Kol Yisrael and in Israel, there's been a tradition from the BBC, I think originally, to be taken seriously, that dignity and a kind of serious broadcast sensibility, speaking from the chest and that sort of thing, is radio's real role. I was interested that in Israel, radio was the early technology and was the most credible one, it's what previous speaker said. In America, the newspapers owned the news for quite some time, and then when the radio was invented, it was the new boy in town. And newspapers were a bit defensive about radio and scared of it. And radio seemed, because it went into the air and then went off to Mars, seemed sort of unreliable, because a newspaper, the print, the story, the facts stay on the page, and you can fetch them the next day and check them. But with the radio, it's just gone. And then television as well, at least for a while. When Orson Welles landed Martians in New Jersey in 1939, had the march across New Jersey on a CBS broadcast, it was the New York Times that ran the most scary, oh my gosh, people thought that was real, and there was riots, and it was a terrible moment in 1939, because this radio, these radio people, they can make stuff up, and you don't know. As if newspapers couldn't, but nevertheless. So radio, in order to defend itself against this newspaper culture, decided, well, okay, we've got to be more believable. So how do we do that? Well, we dress carefully, we look serious, we act knowledgeable, and the broadcast business developed a style, an authoritative, mostly male, mostly tie and jacketed, mostly groomed, I know what I'm saying sort of form. And I remember the first time I was at CBS as a reporter for the very first time in a rehearsal. It was at 4:30 in the morning. And I was on a stool, and there were three cameras all gathered around me. They said, okay, we're going to go ahead, run through your script. It'll be on the teleprompter. And I started to speak.
And the man was putting on a microphone, and he said, I was just talking, and he said, shh, shh. What? Take it out of your nose. I said, is there something in my nose? He said, no, no, take your voice out of your nose. Can't talk like this on the CBS. I said, I'm not talking like this. I'm talking like this. He said, it sounds more like this. I said, they'll fire you if you talk this way. And I was sitting there with all the cameras gathered around on my first day, and I thought to myself, this is how I sound. I'm sorry if I have a larger nose than that guy, or that my voice is up there, but I'm not going to lower my voice into some kind of pretend voice. I know how to do that, but I would feel like a cartoon if I were the... So I'm not going to begin my job here sounding like somebody that you made up or that you want. Here I go. I'm going to go through the nose. And I did. And I honestly wondered whether they'd fire me that day or not. They did not. I don't know why they did not, because a few days later I started to cry when something went wrong on the air. But nevertheless, there are subjects also, I think, where being serious is not the best way to be. When the subject is complex, economics, or law, or diplomacy, or science, or military technology, there is an advantage, I think, to relaxing the way you tell the story. Because a lot of people in the audience, when a science story comes on, thinks, well, I'm not going to get this, this isn't for me. But if you do it more gently, and you show your confusion, you can let people... Well, they say, well, he doesn't seem to understand it either. So then all of a sudden it's like you're under the table holding hands with your audience. The restaurant business has long, long, long ago figured this out. If you're having a formal dinner, the table is usually 26 inches off the ground. So when you put your elbows on the table, your back is straight. Usually the glasses are high, the napkins are fluted, the candelabras are high, and everybody's sort of straight up because it's a formal affair. But if you're running a nightclub, you drop the table to 24 inches, you put your elbows on the table then, and the two of you are at an angle of incline. I mean, you're just lower down, which means you have kissing space right there. And that's an architected bit of relaxation. Essentially, what Radiolab did is we tried to architect a kind of relaxation. We found, honestly, that the more we admitted we didn't know, the more effective we seemed to be in we were basically teaching people what it's like to be curious and not knowing. So let me just give you an example of how we do this with form. One time we were interested in the autonomic nervous system. So if you're walking through a forest and a lion comes running out of the forest, you don't think, oh, there's a lion, I've got to leave here now. You just go, and you run right away. That happens automatically. There's no conscious decision. Somehow your body has picked up the alarm and sets you going. And what happens is right away your mouth gets dry, right away your muscles tighten, right away you don't want to have to go to the bathroom. You don't even think about that. You lose any sense of being hungry. All you're into is running and getting away. And this happens without any voluntarism. It's autonomic. The interesting thing we learned is that while it turns on in human beings the same way, it turns off in men and women differently. And this is a problem that people run into all the time in regular life. So here's how we decided to do it. When we play this, it's time we're going to play this now. This is the Robert and Tamar one. We were having a conversation, and the way Jed organized it is the telephone will ring for some reason, and the person you're hearing is my actual wife playing my wife.
Jed?
Yes.
Listen to this, just for a second.
Well, then...
Wait. I forgot. Stop. I should tell you about playfulness first. I got ahead of myself. When we're talking about relaxing, we decided to do a piece. I'll get to the Tamar thing in a minute. We decided to do a piece about numbers, which is like nobody does stories about math. It's just completely frightening. And we decided what we'd do is we just adopt the frightening problem and we directly deal with it. So I said to Jed, you don't want to hear talk about numbers, and I do. And we chose Johnny Cash, the musician, as my accomplice. So here's what we did. Go ahead.
Jack?
Yes.
Listen to this, just for a second.
Well, they're building a gallows outside my cell. I've got 25 minutes to go. And the
is that Johnny Cash?
Yes, it's Johnny Cash, and he's singing a song about the deep importance of mathematics in your life.
I got 24 minutes to go. Well, they gave me some beams for my last
meal. There's no math here. What are you talking about?
You know, there's a lot of math here because you see what he's doing is he's moving to his extinction, it seems. But he's being very careful to calibrate.
I got 22 minutes to go. Well, I sent for the governor and the whole darn bunch with 21 minutes to go. And I sent for the mayor, but he's out to lunch. I got 20 more minutes to go.
Oh, my God, we're going to go all the way to one? I feel like I've been listening to this song for 3 hours already. The numbers are making it tedious. If I were him, I'd lose the numbers.
You'd lose the numbers?
Yes.
You can't lose the numbers. You cannot lose the numbers because numbers create order in your life.
I could lose the numbers. I could survive an entire, well, my whole life without them.
That's just completely ridiculous.
Easily.
No.
Try me.
All right, let me just ask you something very simple.
Yeah.
You go to buy some M&Ms and you have a $5 bill in your hand and you give it to the vendor and the vendor gives you back the M&Ms and what?
No numbers required. I hand him the bill, he hands me some change. I just go by trust.
You go by trust.
Yeah.
He asked you how old you are. What do you say?
I'm middle-aged, I tell him.
With 4 minutes to go.
Listen to that. You hear that? Suppose that you're late for an appointment or something like that.
Mm.
Yeah? So yeah. You call up and you say, I'm going to be 3 minutes late, 5 minutes late, 10 minutes late?
How? I usually just wait for the call before I leave.
I know that.
Which you know is true.
I know it's true.
So, yeah, don't need them. Don't need them.
You're a test. You're taking a test in school. You get a 98. You get a 52. You don't care?
Pass, fail.
How much gas is in your car, Jen?
I wait for the light to come on.
Suppose you want to call me. Right? Yeah, and you can't remember my phone number.
Two words. What? Speed dial.
How many words?
He said two words. Two words.
You see, you gotta use numbers.
I got 2 more minutes to go. I can see the buzzards. I can hear the crows. 1 more minute to go. And now I'm swinging and here I go.
Is that how it ends?
Yeah.
That's a great ending.
An ending made possible all thanks to the disciplined use of numbers.
Okay.
Yeah. That's going to be our...
So what we do is we are setting up a sort of musical basis to this show where you don't quite know what's coming next. And we're also setting up an attack on knowingness. I mean, in normal journalism, the reporter gets the assignment, the reporter studies the material, the reporter gathers facts, the reporter and the editors check the facts, they get a script, and then they go on the air when they are absolutely sure that what they have to say is perfect. What we do is kind of the opposite. We go on the air announcing that we don't know what we're doing, and then you listen to us argue, as you just heard there, or stumble, or get things wrong. We interview people and learn different lessons from them. We ask really stupid questions. That part is usually left out. We leave it in. We also like it when a fire engine goes by, when headphones fall off. We like to anecdotalize. And what we're doing, I think, is we are trying as hard as we can to give you the experience of what it would actually like to be curious. And we just basically, as I said, we kind of hold your hand through the process. Sometimes we play with form. And that will bring me to the thing I was about setting up. With form, you do it, you create an excitement by creating complete surprise. People do not know. I mean, if I were to sing to you a song that went ba da dum da 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 ba da dum da 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 ba da dum da 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 ba da dum da 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 da, all right, around now you'd go out and get a sandwich. Ba da dum da 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 da, because you know exactly what's coming. Ba da dum ba da da da. In this next piece, there is no way you can leave because you don't quite know what's going on. In this moment, didn't quite know what was going on. My wife
thought she knew what was going on, but she got a little carried away with what was going on. In other words, this is almost chaos, but not at all. Okay.
Now yeah, that feeling is completely rooted in your flesh.
Well,
the brain has nothing to do with it.
A thought made me sad, and then my body felt.
Oh, crap. I forgot to turn the ring off. Hold on. Hello? Oh, hi. Yeah, hold on a second. It's your wife.
Here? Hello?
Robert?
Yeah.
I can't believe you're still there. What are you doing there?
What do you mean, what am I doing here?
You were supposed to be home an hour ago.
Tamar, you've called me in the studio. We're on the air.
I don't care.
What do you mean you don't care?
You were supposed to be home an hour ago. I reminded you this morning. I reminded you last night.
It's
just not important to you.
There's not such a big deal. I'll be back in 10
minutes. Actually, this is a perfect example of what we've been talking about.
No.
Robert's having a fight with his wife, Tamar, and while he's fighting, inside his body, his stomach is clenching, his heart is palpitating, hers is doing the same. Their brains are picking up these signals and thinking, anger. Feel angry.
So I'm working with other people here. There are other people who...
My work is just as important as your work, and you've now screwed it up.
How did I screw it up? How did I screw up your work?
Now, at a certain point, Robert will probably realize he has screwed up, and...
Just get home.
He'll apologize.
Okay, if I get home in 20 minutes, well, I'm really sorry. I know this is horrible.
Robert, is everything okay?
Yeah, it's just a sec. I'm really sorry.
Okay.
Maybe like...
Now, when it comes to brains and bodies and men and women, the interesting thing is that when a man and woman fight, these systems in their body, the heart palpitating, the stomach clenching, while these systems do turn on at the same speed...
And it takes like 2 seconds.
According to Robert Spolsky...
Where there's an interesting gender difference is how long it takes to turn off the system.
And ladies, sorry in advance.
And in general, it turns off more slowly in women than in men.
Which may explain something that happens to couples all the time.
Okay, I'm really sorry.
This just isn't right.
I know. Well, I'm really sorry.
Like, here we are.
Maybe later we'll go do something, or I'm really sorry.
Robert's stomach is relaxing.
And this is really stupid, I know.
His heart is slowing.
It's very stupid.
He thinks the fight might be over.
Okay. But, you know, this is something you do all the time. Remember when we were having a dinner right after we got engaged and we went to the restaurant and I was waiting for you and I made the reservation and
that was in the Carter administration.
I was sitting there for like 45 minutes. You didn't even call.
I just apologized.
Did you hear what just happened there?
It's this William James stuff coming back to haunt us a century later.
Sapolsky says sometimes the body actually tricks the brain. Tamar knows the fight is over mentally, but her body is still tense. Her heart is still racing and her brain thinks, wait.
If my heart is still racing and I consciously know that this issue has been resolved, it must be because I'm still pissed off about that thing that happened in the Carter administration.
You minimize everything everybody does for you.
The brain fills a vacuum.
What, do you have a list? You have a list there or something?
I do. I have a long list. Do you know how often you do this sort of thing?
I do it like once.
No, I can count on this. You know, the babysitter calls if I'm going to be out of town and says, should I make dinner for Robert? Because, of course, you can't make dinner for yourself and the kids. No.
I do make dinner. I don't do much of anything. Baked potatoes last week, Wednesday. I made the baked potatoes.
That's just applying heat.
My baked potatoes just applying heat. This does go on when Robert Sapolsky, we can take a... explains that when his wife and he have that, he says he reminds her, because they're both scientists and not reporters, that this is just, you know, the autonomic nervous system half-life, and they kiss and make up with that. But the thing is, this happens all the time, but who knew that it was science, you know? So what we like to do sometimes is we like to go into your life and tell you, notice this? Well, here's an explanation. So you're very, very familiar with what's going on, but you didn't know that there's a lesson in it. There's also... while we play with form and while we play with dignity, we also play with voice. And I've begun to notice that something kind of radical has been going on. In the 1950s and the 1960s and the 1970s, there was a man at CBS News in America named Walter Cronkite, who was very important and very dignified. And he always spoke in short sentences, active tense. The street was never crossed by anyone. He crossed the street kind of sentences. And he spoke with the authority of a person who was very much in knowledge. We have reporters, particularly the younger ones now, who are going almost to the other side of the rainbow. It's really interesting to me to see. For example, we had a story
very interesting moral story in which a man had a tumor. The tumor caused him to do terrible sexual things, including to order pictures of little girls, very little girls, and masturbate to them. And that it is illegal to buy those kind of pictures and store them in your computer in America. He was arrested. His defense was, it wasn't me, it was my tumor. But during the day, he was able to resist, at work, he was able to resist the temptation of doing what he felt he was, just had to do, until evening when at home he would then indulge. And the judge was wondering out loud whether his ability to withhold the desire by day didn't suggest that he not only had a moral sense, but he was violating his moral sense by surrendering it at night. The reporter that we assigned to this, a kid named Pat, it's a very difficult thing to sit down with a person who's committed such a crime and to talk to him about his motive. So he's nervous and he's scared. So I want you to listen to, this is, he then handed me this tape, and Jad, this tape, and I said to him, are you sure you want me to leave the question in this way? And he said, yes, I am. Yes, I am. Like, he kind of was energetic about it. I want you to listen to this question. I know that Walter Cronkite would never have allowed this on the air, but this is a question which he's so scared he can hardly speak. Let's go ahead and listen to this.
You say it disturbed you and you feel terrible, but I just like wonder, like, how do you tell yourself, like, that wasn't me? Like, how do you explain it to yourself so that you can kind of, I don't know, not feel like you're as bad as the person who goes there without a brain injury is, you know? Like,
oh, say that again. Ask that question.
I guess I'm just wondering, I don't know, like, knowing that that's a thing that you did, and it sounds like, obviously, you know that was bad, it was a wrong thing, and it was a terrible thing, but it was you who did it, or was it not? I don't know, you know what I mean?
I don't know, you know what I mean? I mean, that's amazing. I said to him, why would you want to include it this way? He said, I want the audience to know how frightened I was, how uncomfortable I was to ask. It will make the ask and the answer more credible. Interestingly, Walter Cronkite, 50 years ago, would never want to stumble into a scene. He would want to control the scene. But what caught my eye was in the subsequent weeks, Pat began to write stumble into his scripts. So what is that? What's this stumble thing? Said, well, I was sort of thinking. So what are you now putting? Is now like a pretend stumble? He said, well, it's not pretend because I know I'm going to be upset. So no, you've written it ahead of time. That puts you pretty much. If you think that Walter Cronkite is a phony, your child will be making fun of you in due course. Stumble, stumble, stumble. I said, there is an interesting thing going on in this industry. Like, there is a fashion to how you do this sort of stuff. And right now, the package, the BBC package, is so strong and so objectionable and so false that younger people think, all right, well, we can just throw that up in the air. But they're going to do it a little too consistently, and the whole thing will reverse, and so the curse will be on them in eventually. So there's voice, there's structure. I think our greatest invention, it wasn't mine, it was Jad's, is the music part. I want to just show you what our show looks like on a computer. You can listen to it on a computer also if you want to hear what it sounds like, but I'll just show it to you. Can we just show the first Jad slide? So this is just the two of us talking. So Jad might be the pink guy, he goes blah 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 blah, and then I'm the yellow. That's just us. And that's what it looks like on a computer. Now typically, if we do the second slide, if you want to, you can put honk honk beep beep honk honk beep beep. So honk honk beep beep honk honk. So that's just what's called ambience, and you all know that. The next way to do it, if you're the This American Life that has been referred to, is you put music here. So you go, so you don't have basically a four-level thing. But now here's what Radiolab looks like. We have an orchestral underpinning. What my partner has done is he has listened to the first two lines and thought about how they might be sailed on a sea of sound.
And the sound that he constructs is designed to call your attention to the idea, to the challenge of the idea. It's to give you rests when you need a rest. It's to push you forward when you need a push. It is essentially a soundtrack to a nonfiction radio piece. And the first time he showed me what he could do, this was about 11 years ago, he just handed me something and said, here's what I've been working on. And I said, I have never heard anything like this before at all. And I realized almost at once that it was going to be spectacular. Now, to let you hear how it actually works in real life, I'll take you to a simple thing. We were talking to a scientist, a very good scientist named Cecilia Kenyon. And she was working with worms, just normal earthworms. I think they were earthworms, or maybe they were nematodes. Anyway, little worms or bigger worms. And she had gotten them to live twice as long as they normally do by suppressing a gene in this animal. So the animal had a gene that was sort of a gene that was sort of making it get old, which was basically a natural gene. And then there was a repairing gene that would make it get young again. And she decided to silence the making it old part. But when we had the first interview, even though she's a wonderful, wonderful scientist, let me just play you what it sounded like raw to talk to her. She will be calling these genes by their official names, DAF2, D-A-F-2, and D-A-F-16, DAF2. So here's how it goes. We'll just play it for like 30 seconds.
The DAF16 gene makes a protein called the DAF16 protein. And that protein binds to the DNA where other genes are, and it activates or deactivates a whole bunch of other genes in the DNA. So the way it works is that the hormone binds to the DAF2 receptor, and when that happens, DAF2 receptor kind of squashes the activity of DAF16. It turns it down. Okay, so DAF16 can't.
So she's
bind
trying,
to its
and she's using
genes in the DNA and make
a lot of words, good verbs: squash, so turn down. You understand those? The nouns are a problem here. DAF2, and it doesn't seem to signify. So we decided we would give this a little noun therapy. So let's just hear the same interview after we finished with it. And then you'll hear some of the ocean of sounds. This is on the second one.
So what exactly...
This is the after one.
Yeah. So what exactly is this gene doing to make them live longer?
Well, maybe we should ask the question a different way. Because the worms that lived longer, they didn't actually have this working gene.
Right. When we make a mutation in the DAF2 gene, we damage it. That actually causes it not to work as well. So that actually is kind of profound. That tells you right away that the worm has a gene in it that's shortening the worm's lifespan.
Which is why she calls it
the Grim Reaper gene.
The Grim Reaper gene.
It's the gene that makes you die.
If you're a worm.
Right. So by damaging this gene, Cynthia and her team essentially are taking the Grim Reaper and knocking his knees out.
No, stop that!
Okay, so the question is, what exactly is the DAF2 doing to make the cell age more quickly?
Here's where the story gets a little weird.
Well, we found another gene whose name is also DAF, but it's a different DAF. It's called DAF16.
DAF16!
And this is a gene whose normal function is to keep you young. It's like a fountain of youth gene.
Yeah!
So wait, there was a Grim Reaper gene before.
Right.
And now there's a Fountain of Youth gene?
That's what she discovered.
And inside the worms, these genes are struggling with each other. Here's how it works when a worm ages normally.
The DAF2 receptor...
DAF2.
...kind of squashes the activity of DAF16. It turns it down.
Silence!
And so the worm ages.
Okay. So when you come along and you inhibit the activity of the DAF2 receptor...
Ouch!
Now you liberate DAF16.
Yippee!
It's free. It springs into action. And it activates about 100 genes...
1, 2, 3...
...in the DNA.
Go!
These 100 genes each do a little tiny good thing for the cell. And altogether, it makes the cell live twice as long.
So if you're asking... do experts mind? I mean, you could not do this to Cynthia Kenyon without asking her permission. So we said to her, we're going to, and then we had her edit it so that it was correct. It's fascinating to me how many very serious scientists doing very significant work will agree to have their work cartooned in this fashion if we give them the respect of our attention, because they know what we're trying to do. We're just trying to give them as big an audience for what they do as we can. So in a world where experts are so powerful, the last thing I guess I want to say is we also have a political sense that we want to instruct our audience into not bowing down in the face of expertise. That if somebody announces that thus and thus is so, and they have a long beard, or they have a PhD, or they have a Your Excellency, or they're very important, you are still, as a Democrat, lowercase d, in the world, you're allowed to say, what? I didn't understand what you just said. Does this mean that if an elephant were to cross the street, that are you saying that it would fall down in the middle of the street? Or whatever you want to say. And you will get their funny looks, and you will get a little bit of their scorn. But you will give your listeners just enough courage to maybe do it themselves. And that's really important. In the end, you have to have the courage of your sense of beauty. And I think that's what it comes down to. It's really a question of beauty. This is what we want to do. And we're just constantly looking for neat and elegant ways to do it. And the neat thing about working with Jad is we share, even with our different ages and stuff, a sense of how it should in the end sound. There is a thing about being alive. I grew up in the 1960s and the 1970s, so I got used to certain jingles and certain comedy and certain songs and certain machines. I knew typewriters and UPI machines and things like that. Jad grew up in an era of computers. He had different songs, different. He's always afraid that I'm going to suddenly go into Oh, What a Beautiful Morning from Broadway. He hates, I'm always afraid that he's going to go do some techno robotic drum thing. But the fact is, while we come, what you have as a storyteller, the way you tell stories is just you use the music in your head. That's all you've got to tell your story. This is a clash. He has his music, I have my music, and the show is a kind of bargain between generations. And I don't know what exactly has made it so successful. I don't know whether it's his really brilliant, and he was made a genius by the MacArthur Foundation for this, for the work he does in sound, or whether it's the duet, or whether it's just the bravery of the whole thing. I don't know what it is. But what the real deep secret of the show at the end of the day is it's play. Two people who like each other, which is an animal spirits kind of thing. But people come to listen to it for the warmth, the friendship, and the play underneath the storytelling, for the coziness, for the safety of being inside a friendship. And news is what we're selling. But play is the real secret ingredient here. I think I can stop. I have other things I could do, but we're kind of getting really close to the time when probably somebody has to go home. If there are any questions, I'll take them. Oh, well, be conscious.
One, two?
Yeah.
Thanks. As I told you earlier, I'm a huge fan. Regarding the warmth and the friendship you spoke about at the end of your lecture, how much of the dialogue between you is scripted?
None. Oh, our system is beyond belief inefficient. What we do is we come up with the subject, or the team comes up with the subject. We then interview people. We then lay out the interviews, and then we then write sort of a kind of point-by-point sort of thing through it. This is in the early days. In the early days, we would literally go into the studio and then talk about it. And then we say, well, this doesn't work, and we didn't even know that, and so on. So then we go out, get the new information, go and sit and do it again, and then sit and do it again, and then sit and do it again. And we'd make cuts of the cuts. So what you are hearing is not a script. You're hearing, it's more like a jazz recording. You're hearing a series of improvisations sort of stuck together. In more recent years, where we've been promoting the work of other people, it becomes really kind of ridiculous to have like third and fourth parties. So we have got sort of scripts, but then when we go into the room and we've got it sort of written down, then Jad will say to me, okay, now
he uses an impolite word, but it's an F word. He goes, F it up, meaning if it says Jack and Jill went up the hill, he says, no, just do anything. I go, okay, Jack, you know where he's going, don't you? He's going up the hill. He says, no, less. Go, okay, Jack, he has a road to hoe. It's an uphill road. No, too little. So, okay, Jack, I think he's going to go higher now. I don't know, maybe. Yeah, I like that, but make it longer. Go, Jack, he's going to go higher and higher and higher until he can go no higher. Says, no, he's gonna get to the top. Okay, sorry. Jack, he's gonna go higher and higher and higher to the top of the hill where he will fetch something. No, don't go to the fetch part. Don't go to the fetch part. So it's like that. And it's very humiliating. I spent like 30 years at CBS, and I find myself sometimes in the room going, hey. He says, no, that's not hey, but hey. So what, you don't like the keys? Yeah, no bad, wrong key. I go, hey. And then I think, I hate this. But it's all for a purpose. It's literally, he can hear an orchestral idea that he has to, sometimes we'll argue about it and it'll change in the doing. Like I'll say, that's awful. So here's a whole nother way to go. And then he'll fold his arms across his chest and then we have a moment. And then it can get pretty rough actually, but it's inside a friendship, though. And also, I've raised children, so I there's nothing, he can't bite me anywhere I haven't been bitten before. But he does bite. So it's sort of like, it's interesting. I've never done anything like this, and it's deeply inefficient. We only do 12 a year. We do all the shorts, we do other things in addition. But it's a system that we sort of, it came up between us in the middle of our generational battle. And our generational battle is significant. I mean, he wanted to call the audience bitches one time. I said, you can't call the audiences that. He says, bitches, we'll be right back. We'll be right back, bitches. I said, no, it doesn't matter where it is in the sentence. You can't say that. He says, why can't I say that? Me and my peeps, we like, that's what we say. That's how we talk. I said, I don't care. It's like the other peeps, like my peeps, are going to go, what? You can't. He says, you give me one bitch. I said, I'm not giving you any bitches. So we put his bitch on, and all hell broke loose. But then later, when it was Thanksgiving, I said to his mom, his parents are my age, so I said, why don't you, when you give him some like string beans tonight at Thanksgiving dinner, just say, here, bitch. So the phone rings, and I says, what's wrong with you? Can't you stop? Why would you have my mother do that? I said, if you can't take it, you shouldn't be dishing it out. Cool. So it's sort of a generational thing. It's interesting.
I love the way you took the show live on stage. Why didn't you ever film it and put it online for people in Israel to watch? Or wherever?
We filmed one of them. It's extremely, extremely expensive to film these things. So I should say, we are constantly trying to raise money for ourselves. Ira Glass, the aforementioned This American Life person, is a natural businessman. And I don't know what happens, but he's also one of my best friends. So we sit at breakfast sometimes, and I'll say, we made a pitch to our quadrillion people, and we got like 50%. You made a pitch to your quadrillion people, and you got twice as much. Like, what happened? He says, well, because you this, and because you that, and because you this. But I don't exactly know. He's just uncannily good at raising money. So we do completely inefficient ways to raise money. So we launch entire shows with puppets and dancers, and we went to 29 cities in like about 38 days, and I'm an old man. I mean, I was on a bus with comedians and musicians who, like, you say to them, okay, for 45 minutes now, we can all go to sleep. They go to sleep immediately on anything, on thumbtacks. And all I'm doing is looking at telegraph poles. 1, 2, 3, 4. And I'm dying. I mean, I thought I might actually be dying. So it's not the easiest way to keep company with these horrible people who are all 28 or whatever they are. But it's sort of exciting, and it's a little bit, it used to be flattering. Now I'm not sure what it is, but it's interesting. One time in Dallas, a high school friend of mine comes, oh, I hear you're in town, you're going to do a stage show. I said, just come and let's talk about President Eisenhower and things that these people know nothing of, just so we can just walk and talk together. He said, are you crazy? I said, no, I don't even know anything about President. Doesn't matter, just mention his name many, many times. So it is there's probably a sale-by ticket on this thing, this Radiolab, but it is, one of the bravest things about it is it's in a way about love. It's just, I mean, it's not like we're gay or anything, but we have a very, we have a real honest-to-goodness friendship. And at one point, we were a little bit afraid to let it be evident. I thought, I said, no, actually, people are animals, and they have an animal smell, an animal sense about them. And they'll hear this comfort level, and they'll like that. Whatever we're talking about. We could be talking about lumber in Ontario. But if it were two people who liked each other, maybe they'd say, oh, well, that's nice. Lumber in Ontario. That's nice people. And I said, that's a strategic advantage we have. Let's use it. So we still do.
Thank you very much. Robert Kulvitz was amazing. Quite amazing.